Like, I did have that conversation with Moby at some point where it was like, you know, you need to get to the next level mm-hmm. and solve your own things. But for me in that moment, I selfishly just wanted to pick the brain of the people around me. You know what I mean?
Yeah, so
I was in that really kind of selfish mindset because I really wanted to go around the people around me, but I wasn't helping the business and I wasn't helping myself ultimately. So yeah, that discussion really kind of pushed me into the direction I needed. Stop coming to me with your problems, come with your solutions.
Welcome to the Marketing Mentors Podcast, brought to you by Red Pandas Digital. I am Tasha and you are Linda, and today we're talking about problems.
Yeah.
If you didn't pick up what Linda just said, and specifically solving problems and taking those problems to completion. Now, we draw a lot of inspiration from Leaders Eat Last by Simon Sinek. It's a book. I just finished reading it. And like in all true, book club forms, we share lots of stuff in our book club Slack channel amongst the leaders here at Red Pandas. And this was probably two key things that, you know, we've been talking about. We talk about it for years. Mm. We always talk about it. We went through it. And I feel like he articulates it really well with these two paragraphs specifically, that we've said solve your own problem and push to completion. So what are we talking about with solve your own problem? if I can, we'll just take, you know, a little bit of time to reflect.
Mm.
And I know you went through something similar when you first started here at Red Pandas, that is. And when I first started in account management, in digital marketing, working with, you know, Mobs, there were these, you know, problems that would come to us. And, you know, I think it was probably a balance of like inexperience and then also like trying to earn your stripes and do the right thing and that type of stuff. But
yeah,
sometimes there were times where you just didn't know really how to approach something or didn't know how to solve a certain problem. And, you know, I'd take it to Mobs and say, oh, this has happened. And he'd just kind of look at you and be like, and what do you want to do about it?
Yeah.
And so I think we were really fortunate to have been coached exactly with what you just said, like don't come to me with problems. And I think he even said these words.
Yeah.
Don't come to me with problems, come to me with solutions. Mm. And so now we have that mind frame and we've had it since then of, okay, here's a problem, solutions mode straight away.
I think a lot of people come to this learning in completely different ways.
Yep.
You know, you can, like you said, you can have our sort of experience where you do just come a really great, you come you work with a really great leader, rather, and they do kind of probe and push you to be able to kind of figure out that on your own because they want you to grow.
Yeah.
You know, other people will have bosses that are really dismissive and will kind of have to learn to do that on their own because they're dealing with a leader or a boss, manager, whatever, that doesn't really want to help them grow but is more so dismissive and is making them kind of figure it out on their own.
Yeah.
You know, if you have an entrepreneurial background and, you know, you've started a business, well, then you've probably learnt this the hard way.
Yep.
You know, because it's obviously lonely and you don't have people around you, right? So you're working out your own solutions on your own, you know, utilizing the resources that you have. So I feel like there are different ways to kind of get to this point where you can solve your own problems.
Yep.
For us, we've been quite blessed in that way. Like Tasha said, you know, we both have had that learning through Moby, I would say. You know, for me individually, I think I came from a background where because I wasn't around marketers, I was doing a lot of solving on my own. So I was, you know, going on Google and doing online courses, and I didn't really have the resources around me to ask questions. So I think coming to Red Pandas, for me, what I really wanted out of this selfishly was to be able to learn off people around me and not have to solve my own problems because I wanted to utilize the expertise of the people around me.
It's funny though, because even though you didn't want to solve your own problems, by default, because we're all such good problem solvers,
you did
learn those things in
a way.
Well,
I did have a hard reality. Like I did have that conversation with Moby at some point where it was like, you know, you need to get to the next level and solve your own things. But for me in that moment, I selfishly just wanted to pick the brain of the people around me. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that makes sense.
So I was in that really kind of selfish mindset because I really wanted to go around the people around me, but I wasn't helping the business and I wasn't helping myself ultimately. So, yeah, that discussion really kind of pushed me into the direction I needed to go in, as opposed to like relying on the people around me, I would say, because I was quite selfish in that manner, you know?
Yeah. Okay.
So yeah, it was interesting how that kind of happened. And yeah, it kind of pushes you into a different trajectory because you start to look at problems in a different way.
Yeah, completely different.
You know what I mean?
Completely different. It's a mindset. You don't, like, and I said before, you're not a problem finder. You're a problem solver.
Mm.
Like, you look for problems to solve. You see a problem as an opportunity to broaden your knowledge, to cultivate a relationship, to gain new interpersonal skills, to learn how to interview someone.
Mm.
I'm sure there's plenty of problems that I could go to Moby with that he'd be able to tell me how to solve or point me in the right direction. But I'm like, what's that doing for me? What's that doing for my – it's also still selfish in a way, because I'm like, no, I want to build that skill. Mm. I want to know how to build, you know, like right now a problem that I'm working on, which I'm sure Mobes could give me the solution or point me in the right direction.
Yeah.
But that's not the way that I want to approach the problem. I can't find the solution or the support in the organization right now.
Yeah.
I think as well the
higher – what is that problem that you're trying to solve?
I'm trying to do some like reporting for our time tracking, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Just to summarize it. And no one in the business right now I can really lean on for what I need to solve. So solving your own problem means finding an avenue to do that. So if it's finding an operations manager at an agency somewhere else that can share some insight, if it's building a new LinkedIn connection and then DMing them and say, hey, can we line up a time to talk, to solve the problem that you know someone in your organization – we're all problem solvers. We could all solve each other's problems, but is it really the best use of everyone's time? Isn't that what I'm getting paid to do?
I think there's something interesting there, T. Like you said, you know, reach out to another agency, like affiliate. It kind of feels like some people as well that I've come across in my time, like they might have other things standing in their way that would stop them from being able to finesse this. Like what I mean is being able to leave your ego at the door, you know, being able to ask for help, being able to get other people to help solve your problems. Yeah, like I've seen people's egos stop them from doing that.
Yep.
And so they ultimately aren't put in that problem solver category.
Yeah.
And they don't finish things to completion because they are letting their ego get in the way of them being able to do that as well.
Yeah.
So it's quite interesting that because ultimately that helps you, right? I mean, I lean on my partner a lot, funnily enough. Like he's got no marketing experience, but I also find just asking someone that is in a different industry that is looking at it from a clean slate really helps me sometimes when I'm making decisions, maybe not marketing related decisions, but like, you know,
people skills,
handling certain conversations, people skills, that sort of thing.
Yeah. No, yeah. That's a really good point you make. So I think that's what differentiates maybe like, I'm being general here. You've got more junior team members, less experienced team members. And problem solvers versus problem finders. We all know someone that's a problem finder.
Yeah, yeah.
We know someone that everywhere you go, problems follow them.
Yeah.
They're problem finders.
Mm.
They know how to find problems and they know how to whinge and they know how to complain. We're not talking about these people. We want to be the problem solvers. We want to be the person that people are coming to help them solve their problems. And then as leaders and as communicators, we coach and guide them on how they can then solve their own problems.
Yeah.
Because if we constantly solve everyone else's problems, we're in this perpetual cycle.
Totally. Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? And we've got to step away from that.
Yeah.
So I think that's a differentiator as well. Something we've really worked on in the last 12 months.
Yeah.
Is now that we're really good problem solvers within the business, let's help our team become like that.
Yeah.
Because ultimately, Linda, if we can step away from the business and it runs on its own, we know that we've done what we need to. We've created a team of problem solvers.
That's definitely something that we're actively working on. Creating a team of problem solvers.
Every
so day. If someone comes to me or you with a problem, it's always put in reverse.
Yep.
Not in a way that makes them feel like, hey, I'm putting it back on you. You figure it out.
Mm-hmm.
But it's put in reverse to get them to open up. Or, you know, a really great way of doing this is saying, I have an idea, but I'm curious to hear your thoughts first.
Yeah.
And a lot of the times when you say that, your idea is the same as theirs, but getting them to verbalize it allows them to start to solve their own problems. Yeah. And I think that's the first step, kind of putting it back on them in that moment in a way that doesn't make them feel like you don't care about solving that with them, but then getting your team to a point where they can solve it before they come to you.
Yes.
And then you know, carry that proactiveness into the conversation.
Yeah.
So ultimately what you want your team to be able to do is to solve that problem, and then you perhaps not even hear about it until you're one-on-one. Maybe it's just a line dropped, hey, had this thing sorted out, this is what I did.
Yep.
Or have your team
yep.
try and figure it out and then proactively come to you, not waiting for that one-on-one with you,
yep.
but coming to you early and scheduling that time, like, hey, I've got a problem, I'm thinking of a solution, need to touch base with
yeah.
you.
Yeah, that's a good point you mentioned, Linda, because, yeah, there's fires that we all put out every day with our clients that, you know, Moby's not aware of. But then there's bigger fires that he needs to be aware of very soon. And I think it's ultimately, hey, I don't need you to help me solve this problem, but I've got these flags right now.
Yeah.
But as a good communicator, as a good employee as well, you have an obligation to your employer
yeah.
to let them know what's going
and
on in their business.
And escalate things when they
right?
need.
Right, escalate yeah. them when they, like that's, to me, I think that's just common sense, but yeah. you know, each of their own. and hey, this thing's happening, it's okay, it's cool, I've got it handled, I'm just letting you know what's happening.
Yeah.
And that is communication. That's communication and that's communication and your problem solving skills working together.
It's so true. It's about knowing how to read the room. Hey, because you can look at it two ways. You can be like, okay, you almost go too far with this.
I've had this problem.
Hey, I've solved all my problems. I've gotten solutions. You don't need to know about it. And your employee, colleague, whatever it is, doesn't mention anything, which I think is taking that too far.
Too far, yep.
But then there's being able to be a problem solver,
yep.
but then also flag things that are in green, orange, or red traffic lights, if you will.
Yep. One of the earlier accounts before I think you were hired, we lost because Moby handed over to me probably too soon. I didn't raise things soon enough. And and it was lost because the client was just like saw red one day and I hadn't picked up the flags. I hadn't received any of that stuff. I just thought we're just plodding along, doing our job. I was giving.
Yeah.
Over-servicing for sure.
Yeah.
And then like not meeting
They're always the ones, aren't they?
And then not actually meeting the, you know, objective key results, for example, for the client. And then all of a sudden it was like, boom, clash, gone. And we've gone, okay, cool. We need to have like a good escalation process. We need to have good check-ins. Mm. And I think we've done really well with that stuff now. And we train every new red panda to solve their own problems.
Yeah.
And one of our values, which I know we're going to be readdressing soon, but I can't see this one going anywhere. We might change the word, but this autonomy. This responsibility, this ownership.
Yeah.
That's your problem. You need to solve that problem.
Yeah.
And it's not that we're not here. Mm. We are here for you, but we're not in the market of creating people that are dependent on their leaders. We want you to be a leader too. We want you to grow to the point that you don't need us to hold your hand through every single thing that you do. Mm. Simon Sinek wraps it up really nicely. So the goal here for solving your own problem isn't simply just to have another person other than your boss give you step-by-step instructions. So how we're talking about, if your boss can't give you the answer or your mentor or whatever, go outside your circle, find what you're looking for. And what that gives you is an ability to develop relationship with someone who knows more.
Yeah.
And then they can guide you or act as a sounding board for you to figure it out. So you have to put your ego aside.
Yeah.
You have to. This will not work if you let your ego steer you wrong, because you have to admit, I don't know how to solve this and I don't know the answers and I don't have the knowledge, but I know someone else has it. I literally use it all the time with HubSpot. Like when a client comes to me, they want to do something and I'm like, I don't know, but you're not going to be the first one that's had this problem, so I know where to go to find the solutions.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So just put your ego aside. You don't need to know everything. You just need to know where to go and how to ask and how to communicate back to the person, hey, I don't know how to solve that problem, but that's okay because we're going to figure it out.
Yeah, yeah.
And people want that assurance. Do you know what I mean? That's more valuable than having all the answers.
So true.
Oh, my God, I just said an enlightenment right there. You know what I mean? Yeah, it's incredible.
I think something that we are starting to really realize now that we are hiring new employees looking for an account manager at the moment is where
we're
really
looking, let us know.
Totally. if you're interviewing with us, we're definitely being a lot more deliberate with the types of questions that we ask, because we are definitely wanting to be more intentional in trying to see whether people are problem solvers in the interview process.
Or problem finders.
Yeah, yeah. Or problem finders, exactly. And Tasha can share more about this because she's been doing a little bit more of like that questioning track. But there's a book, we'll link it in the description, where this is kind of taken from. But there's definitely questions that you can ask in the recruitment process that aren't leading questions that help you identify if someone is naturally a problem solver or not.
Yep.
And that's ultimately asking a question that doesn't look for the solution in the question. So asking if someone has had a difficult situation and asking them to talk about that difficult workplace situation.
Yep.
And the way that they talk about that situation, whether they naturally kind of evolve that conversation into how they solved that or a solution shows their mindset and their natural tendency, because people that are problem solvers naturally have a tendency not to be able to kind of
segment
problem from solution. They tend to look at it as one. So
yeah, it's a really,
really interesting how, like, we're working on this internally in the company, but now that we're recruiting, we're really trying to look for these sort of qualities in someone in a really, I think, smart way of questioning.
That book is Hiring for Attitude, A Revolutionary Approach to Recruiting, Selecting People with Both Tremendous Skills and Superb Attitude. It's always been the biggest thing, hiring. You're like, the skill set, I always say skill set, I don't care. I'm like, yeah, okay, you need to have a little bit of this, a little bit of that. But your attitude is way more important. And I remember when I was interviewing, like, for a job many, many years ago, I, like, when I went for a role that was definitely, I did not have the skill set for it, but I'm like, I have the right attitude. And I got really, really far into the interview process, and then someone with more skills got it. And I was like, okay, fair enough. Like, I still tried to boil that ocean. I was like, why not? Right? Yeah, I think your attitude is way more important. So to Linda's point, some of those questions, and what she was talking about, like framing a question in a way that will reveal a problem solver, is you don't want to ask leading questions.
Yeah.
Leading questions are questions that, whether it's subconsciously or consciously, but they are framed in a way that is actually leading the person to the answer you want to hear.
Yeah.
And we all do it a lot.
Yeah.
You know, when you say things like, does that sound good? And like that's actually a leading, you know, question. It is a question.
It is.
It's a leading question because you want them to say, yeah, that sounds great.
Yeah.
And most of the time you get that answer when you ask in that tone with, oh, wow, we should do a whole other episode on like question asking with like tones and stuff.
Yeah. That'd be good. Yeah.
So that particular question Linda was asking, and I've always asked this question in interviews, but I've just got a new way to ask it now. I used to say things like, tell me about a time you made a mistake and what did you do?
Yeah.
Right? That's what I used to say. Now I think particularly the one that I'm looking for.
And can we just break that down quickly? So the reason why we're moving away from that sort of question is because it's leading. The part that's leading is, and what did you do?
Yeah.
Because you're ultimately pushing them for the solution.
Yeah.
And so it's not really revealing much about their mindset.
It's a problem solving question.
It's getting, right? It's getting them to recall an entire track. Well, that's fine. Everyone has that track that they can answer. But what are we actually learning here? We're not learning anything about the mindset.
So this is a good one. Could you tell me about a customer you found particularly difficult to work with? So it was just that question. Could you tell me about a time you were struggling to meet a commitment you had made to a customer or a colleague? Again, not a leading question. It's just tell me about that struggle time. And then obviously naturally, like Linda was saying before, problem solvers will tell you the problem. Like, oh, I had this.
They'll show you the solution.
They'll tell you the solution. Thank you. Can you tell me about a time you were given an assignment that didn't fall within your role? Again, another one is, could you?
So a great response to that, can I just say, like, you know, assignment that didn't fall within your role. I was given, I was given XYZ. It wasn't in my remit. It was really hard, but, you know, I managed to figure out X, Y, and Z to it. And I learned a lot in the process. Like, ultimately, it's not what I wanted to be doing, but, you know, I did learn a lot. That sort of, you know, I did learn a lot. Hearing those, like, sound bites is what kind of shows you, oh, okay.
Growth mindset.
You
know,
growth mindset. Exactly.
You don't want someone that goes, oh, that's not in my job description.
Yeah. We and leaves it at that.
Yeah.
That is telling in an interview.
Yeah.
You know, if you hear something black and white, like, oh, I was given this job to do and I wasn't happy with that. It's not in my 9 to 5.
Yeah, that's it. And, like, people will say that, right? People
totally.
Will say that.
Yeah.
That's a really good one. So when we talk about pushing to completion, so we spoke about this idea of solve your own problem and then push it to completion. So your boss, your manager, your leader gives you something that you need to do.
Yeah.
It might be a simple thing like, hey, can you find out what time that client's available for a kickoff session, right? You go and do the thing. Maybe you email the client because you couldn't call them or whatever.
Yeah.
And then you just never hear back. your boss asks you 2 days later, hey, did, first of all, in my opinion, your boss shouldn't have to follow you up.
Totally.
It's your boss. He gave you a task. Do your job. Right? Okay. But that's just, my two cents. But let's say he follows you up and says, hey, what happened to that client meeting? Did we ever book that in? And they're like, yeah, I emailed the client. They just didn't get back to me.
Yeah.
How many times have you had those conversations?
Mm.
It's like, that's not good enough.
Yeah.
I've given you a task to do and I want you to be a problem solver and I want you to push it to completion.
Yeah.
If I've asked you to book something in, mm-hmm. and this is how I treat myself. So if anyone's listening, they're like, oh, you're hard. Yeah, I'm hard on myself as well. This is what I don't expect anything less. If you're asked to do something, take it to completion.
We are saying this across the board as well. So that's like one of the more simpler examples, right? But then the examples that I feel get people more are the ones where like it's a really challenging thing to solve.
Yeah.
And it's a grind and it takes a lot of hours and it's a pain in the ass and it's a project and you've spent heaps of time on it and you can't figure out a solution.
Yep.
You've maybe tried a few things here and there.
Yep.
And it's there where it's like that extra 10, 5% that you need to give to be able to get it across the line.
Yep.
And it's not getting there to push it to completion. It's like, I've invested all this time, like I've had enough now. It's that as well, which I tend to see a little bit more, you know, in past roles and things like that. Yeah.
Yeah. That's really interesting.
It's the same thing. Yeah. Yep. Two ends of the spectrum.
It's the same skill. Can you grab a problem and own it to completion?
Yeah.
Can you solve it and tick it off on the thing and be like, cool, I've done everything I can on that and then I've moved on. And in what the example you just gave, Linda, as well, again, communication comes up because if you've got clients, if you've got a boss or whatever and you've done that, you've spent hours on the project and you know you physically can't go anywhere further with it, you have to know how to communicate that.
I agree.
To the client or to your boss to say, I've done all of these things and I cannot do any. I physically, not even in my remit, it's in the hands of what I'm able to do.
Yeah.
I can't do anything more. If you want to, these are some next steps that you could take.
Yeah.
But I can't do that.
That's so important. Yeah, I agree to that. Communication is, I think, probably the really important element that kind of ties it off. Because, sure, you can't solve every single problem out there. I totally understand that.
Yeah.
But you're right. It's the communication piece at the end,
yeah.
which I think is really important. And what we were talking about earlier, just being able to escalate things that need to be escalated.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And know when you get tasked something. And I think this was a learning curve for me, for sure. When you get tasked something, that is your ownership. It's your responsibility.
Yeah.
No one should have to follow you up about things. You should grab it, own it, run with it, report back on it.
Mm.
Don't close it off until you've agreed. Like maybe you get a verbal commitment like from the person, hey, can I consider this task done now and complete it?
Yeah.
Sometimes I don't even do that with my team. I just tick it off for them when I know it's done.
Yeah.
Because I'm like, okay, cool. That's cool. I'm considering this done.
Mm-hmm.
But too often I feel like – and that type of stuff feeds into everything you do. It feeds into how your emails are handled. It feeds into how your project management is handled. It feeds into a lot of the things, I think. The way you do anything is the way you do everything.
Yeah.
So if you can – I like that saying, it's very true as well, and it's becoming more and more apparent.
Mm.
If you approach everything you do, everything has like little tiny problems that you own and you solve, it's a mindset. It's a fully mindset change.
Yeah.
That was exciting. Got into that one.
You did.
Yeah. You don't realize and then you start talking about something like, whoa.
I know.
Yeah. Just because I think honestly, like this role and this business, we've been so fortunate or challenging, if you will, to have been in this role.
Pressure is a privilege.
Yeah, yeah. Where we've had to solve our problems. Not that like our leaders haven't been there for us, but that's what's expected. Like there's high expectations and that's because that's how he leads. That's how our leaders lead us, just like that.
Yeah.
So it's expected. That's just the behavior that's expected.
Mm.
Hence why when people come into our workplace and our culture, if they don't have that attitude, they're out the door pretty quickly because it's just they can't keep up.
It's so crazy, isn't it? Because we always did say that, you know, we wanted to build a team with these soft skills and that, you know, in theory, people would be out quite quickly, but we really have started to notice that.
Oh, it's happening.
You know what I mean? Like we've really noticed that these skills that we really have been trying to finesse for a few years now are really so evident within the team that the people that don't have these skills, and if they're not on board to trying to learn these skills, they stick out like a sore thumb.
Yep.
Yeah.
I think it's a privilege that we have such a great team.
I agree.
Yep. So if you think any of these traits sound like you and you are interested in a digital marketing consultant role, hit us up on LinkedIn. We are hiring. We've got some great candidates in the pipeline, I must say.
Yeah.
Maybe one of our episodes in the new year is about like what we've learned through hiring or something.
Yeah.
Who knows? But that is a wrap for 2023.
Wow.
Which is very exciting. Thank you, Linda.
Thank you,
too. For another wonderful year of marketing mentors.
Likewise.